Having said so many things about family, we must not think that everything will go on smoothly because we have enemies of our souls and we will be under attack of the devil. And every intelligent person, whoever is possessing riches, must take sufficient care that he or she would not be robbed. Correct? Therefore, everything is not going to be smooth after all. The enemy is very active. We know it as Christian believers. The devil is prowling and is always ready to destroy the families. There are not only evil forces that are at work, there are also their agents actively involved to break Christian families. And especially the more we get ready, the more the attack would be on us, because the wartime strategy is always to hit the leader. Therefore, you and I are likely to come under an attack of the evil one sooner or later. Therefore, every sensible man or woman must learn the warfare well before any battle is initiated. Tell me an answer. When will they learn the battle? When the battle has started or much in advance? Much earlier. Therefore, this is the time where we are all very happy. This is the time to learn how to fight, so that when the battle really begins, you know how to fight. Shall we begin with a word of prayer? Loving Heavenly Father, we once again come to your help around this time as we contemplate upon the attacks on Christian family. You are equipping us with your riches and we are extremely thankful to you. Your word are full of those riches. The more we dig, the more we find. The more we toil, the more we benefit. The more we apply ourselves to it, the more you are willing to help us. Lord, we thank you so much. But around this time, Lord, we also want to know how the devil attacks us in various ways. So as we meditate upon these things, Father, we pray that you will open our eyes and ears so that proper understanding about our warfare can be taken in at this time. Keep away all tiredness and sleep and disturbance from out of our minds, that we can learn in a free atmosphere around your feet and around your precious word. We seek your help, Lord. We seek your blessing. So grant it to us, because we ask it in the wonderful name of your Son and our blessed Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Attacks on Christian family. We are under attack. Every family, every Christian family is under attack. We must understand this. Nobody can say, I'm not under an attack. It's only an illusion if you say that you are not under the devil's attack. Every family that would like to refine itself and go to the Lord for fruitful life and ministry would be under attack. We know that the devil is a prowling lion to devour not only individuals, but also families. And on the other side, the world is influencing us with great sinful stimuli. And therefore, we need to be very, very alert. We have to protect our own families, as we see what's going on in the family as far as our relationships are concerned. And then we also must know the different ways in which attacks come our way. And the first thing that comes our way is a negative thoughts about the spouse. Why do they occur, the negative thoughts? They occur due to constant thinking about the faults and the failures of one's spouse. See, after all, we are all human. We fail in our responsibilities. We miss to perform well. And unfortunately, we think that even though we are not perfect, we expect our spouses to be very perfect. This is very unrealistic in family. It does not mean that you can behave as you please just because we are human, but don't expect perfectionist performance on the part of your spouse. Therefore, this constant thinking about the failures of the spouse can produce a lot of negative thoughts about the spouse. The devil will always point out at the weaknesses, at the failures of your wife or husband, and then tell you, she is no good, he is no good, and you have been doing all these things and he fails. You do all these things and she fails. How many times will this occur? What a useless wife you have. What a useless husband you have. These things constantly are breathed into our ears and into our minds by the evil one. Sometimes the personality traits which are not acceptable to us also produce these negative traits. For example, the eating habits, certain mannerisms, and certain ways of prayer, certain weaknesses in certain areas of personal lives, or certain amount of uncleanness or untidiness on the part of the spouse can bring in these negative thoughts. You know, we human beings have got a tendency to look at the black spots of people rather than the positive qualities of people. In one Sunday school class, one teacher performed this experiment. She brought a big white sheet of paper and then showed it to the children. What do you see here? Nothing was written. It was all a white sheet of cloth. And then they showed to the children and then said, what do you see here? Then all the children strained their eyes and started examining the whole piece of cloth. And they found one small black dot at one corner of that white sheet. They all said, the black spot, the black spot. Anything else you see here? Nobody said, no, ma'am. Then she said, nobody could see a white cloth in my hand. Then they said, yes, ma'am. See, this is our human frailty. There may be 100 good things in your spouse. We are blind to them. But there may be one thing that causes irritation again and again to you and to me. And we capitalize on those things. And then brand that person by that single failure. And we cancel them out from our list of able people, excellent people. What a foolish activity. Who tells you to do this? The devil. The devil acts on our minds, friends. This is the battleground. If you are a winner in your mind, you are a winner outside. All battles are won in the mind first. That's why so much of positive thinking goes in all the coaching camps and the training camps. He influences our minds about our own spouses and troubles our minds so cunningly that here is my wife who is not useful to me at all. Or here is my husband who is not useful to me at all. Therefore, mutual trust and respect simply evaporate over a period of time. And then selfishness and egoistic outlook develops. I am okay. My traditions are good. my customs are good, my brought up is nice, my parents are excellent, my village is good, my education is nice, my mannerisms are great. You know, kind of an egoistic thinking. And then a lot of selfishness. In marriages, people always think in terms of, what do I get from my wife, from my husband? What do I get today? But the Word of God tells us that we need to live a kind of a life where the passion in our minds would be, what can I render to the other person who has come to live with me the rest of her life, the rest of his life? What can I do for you? What can I do for him? This is what the Lord Jesus Christ always thought. Why did he get up so early in the morning? Why did he go so late in the night? Why was he there praying to the Father all alone on those mountainsides as a lonely figure in the dead of the night, in the wee hours of the day, in the other night? Because he would like to minister to people. He came not to be served. He came to serve and give his ransom for many. The Son of Man has come not to be served, but to serve. Friends, can you substitute that statement of the Lord Jesus Christ by inserting your name there? I have not become a husband to be served, but to serve and give my life for this lady. I have not come here to be served, but I have come here to serve this gentleman. If that is the attitude in a family, whatever may be the pressure coming from the negative attitudes of the spouses, your marriage will still be intact, right? Therefore, we need to understand that every time I begin to think negatively about my wife or a husband, or a little small thing that did not go well with me, or with my ideas, or with my expectations, if I am getting disturbed because of it, I am only doing one thing, I am cooperating with the devil to destroy my family. Remember, there are windows and doors in a family for the devil to enter in. Windows and doors, we keep opening them for the enemy to enter through. These must be kept shut very tightly. Knowingly or unknowingly, if you open those things, the devil is sure to enter and then spoil the whole system. He doesn't do it in a big way. Begins in a small way, with a small mistake, with a small difference. Somebody said, all divorces begin with a difference. I think that's a very valid statement. Divorce does not come like a divorce in the beginning. It all starts with a difference, and therefore, every time you tend to differ, and your wife tends to differ, or your husband tends to differ, draw closer to your spouse. Don't drift away. Draw closer, friend, because the danger, the attack has already started. These are the symptoms of the attack of the evil one. Keep your mind sober. Keep your mind full of love. You see, the only ability that can forgive other people's shortcomings comes from agape love, coming from the Holy Spirit. Love is the first quality of the fruit of the Spirit. Self-control is the last quality of the fruit of the Spirit. Somebody said, I read it in a book, if you start with love, you will end with self-control. Therefore, in between are accommodated all the other qualities of the fruit of the Spirit. We all need love. Don't define love for yourself. Look for the definition in God's Word. Try to understand what agape love is so that you can understand your spouse and don't be selfish. The Word of God says love is not selfish. And if you tend to be selfish and seek only what you can derive out of your spouse all the days of the year, you are a selfish man and you don't know anything of agape love. You are already backsliding. You need a lot of repair. You need repentance. You need cleansing. You need sanctifying grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to be filled in. Your gas tank is already empty. You cannot run for long. You will be stalled and you will be there on the roadside for many years. if the Holy Spirit does not fill you up again. It's time, friends, to sit together and then go to the Lord. Perfectionist attitude, while conscious of one's failures, should not be there at all. I know that I am full of faults, and I don't expect my wife Persis to be perfect. How foolish that is. You see, that's how actually Christian marriages also happen. People will say, I want a good wife, I want a good husband. That's why the right attitude would be, when God gives me a wife or a husband in marriage, will I be the right kind of a bride? Will I be the right kind of the bridegroom for that person? That's what we keep telling to our children. It's good to ask God for a good woman or a good husband. But then, it's also equally important to ask God to make you so good for the wife that is coming in, and so good for the man that is coming in. So, if you extend it into marriage, your question at the end of the day should be, did I serve my spouse well today? Your spouse is there, the Lord is there, and you are there at the end of the day. And the Lord would ask you, what have you done? Can you give me an account of what all you have done with regard to your wife, with regard to your husband? We must be able to say, Lord, I served her. I served him. Thank you so much for the grace. If that can be your answer, how nice that would be. And you have already won one step of the battle. And then how do we counter this attitude? Focus on the positives and not on the negatives. Remember that in marriage, two imperfect people are brought together by God. Two imperfect people, not perfect people. God specializes in bringing two imperfect people and strike a perfect balance, perfect match. Whoever can do it, only our God can do it. And that's how we grow in marriage. That's how we become mature in marriage. Come into God's hands. God can change you. God can bring that perfect oneness that we were talking about on the second day, provided you yield, you let go, and you let God in and ask Him to take over. Our God brings two imperfect people in marriage and strikes a perfect match, made for each other after 20 years. Maybe in the beginning years, people would say, oh, you are not compatible, and whoever has suggested this proposal, I think your marriage will be a failure and all kinds of things. But then yield to God and work in your marriage. Very shortly, people will begin to think, you seem to be made for each other. What a couple you are. How did you make it? That's why we say marriage is hard work. Marriage is hard work. Hard work by both the spouses. If that hard work is missing, the devil will do his hard work. Because the devil is already working hard, we need to work hard too, so that our marriage and our children can always be protected. Condemnation and judgment always come from the devil. Never condemn. You see, you can say one thing. I can tell my wife, you don't seem to be telling the truth, in case I think she's not telling the truth. You don't seem to be telling the truth, but I should never say you are a liar. What is the difference between these two? If I am telling that you seem to be telling the truth, you don't seem to be telling the truth, I'm only saying, only at this one instance, I think you are not telling the truth. But when I say you are a liar, what does it mean? You always tell lies. I'm branding her as a liar. That is judgment. Judgment is not our job. Condemnation is not our job. Helping people like us is our job. Restoring people to the Lord Jesus Christ is our job. And therefore, a normal, healthy Christian will not condemn, will not judge, but try to extend the grace of God that he has received in his own life to the other partner in life who shares life with him or with her. Now, our thought must be taken captive to the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5. Apostle Paul talks about strongholds that are sitting in our minds. It takes a lot of time to explain what a stronghold is. But then, we can also mention in passing the last portion of the 5th verse. We bring every thought captive to the Lord Jesus Christ. What a beautiful discipline in his life. He gets a lot of foolish thoughts. Apostles also get foolish thoughts. Fleshly thoughts. Don't think that apostles are angels. No. They're ordinary men. Extremely disciplined by the Spirit of God. Extremely obedient by their commitment. Of course, there is a call to be apostles. But then if there is no obedience on their part, they would not have been apostles at all. So Paul says, I bring all thoughts captive to the Lord Jesus Christ. What an exercise. Do you think it's an easy exercise? Do you have a control on your thoughts? We don't have control on our thoughts and imaginations. Paul says, our thoughts and our imaginations, our ideas can be captivated to the Lord Jesus Christ. What a victory, friends. What a joyful victory for every disciplined Christian, for every man who would like to win the race. There is a victory waiting, provided you take the course of discipline. And God's disciplines are very hard to endure sometimes. If you have the mind to endure, God will take you to supernatural heights of victory, especially in your thought life. God promises this. Understand these beautiful secrets of victory from the Word of God, from God Himself. God is opening up. And then relationship should be protected jealously. You need that kind of a jealousy, the right kind of jealousy, the jealousy with which you really want to protect something. Maybe you can call zeal, that kind of a jealousy that we need, or zeal that we need. Now, second thing is conflicts through differences. Now, the differences between the spouses can pull us apart. Why? Our ego can be our pride, can be spirit of criticism, harsh words. In fact, most of the differences come because of words. Words. We just do not know how to talk. You see, when our children are born and then when they're growing, when the first few words are coming, mama, dada, these things are coming, oh, the parents are very, very happy, ecstatic. Oh, he called my name. And everybody wants to come to the child and repeat his name there by the child. People are learning words. And believers, when they begin to talk nicely, the Heavenly Father also will feel very happy. And some of them, even after 30 years, we have not learned to talk well. Our lives are full of flaws. Our words are full of flaws. And there is a description of the Lord Jesus Christ in the 12th chapter of the book of Matthew, where it says, he doesn't shout. His voice is not heard in the street. And then he does not break that weak reed, nor snuff out the burning wick, the flickering wick. Now this is your Savior. And in Psalms it is said, and then that grace is poured upon his lips. When he begins to speak, it was grace. Why so many people followed him, including his enemies? Because when Jesus Christ spoke, it was so soothing, so comforting, so wonderful, that people want to just follow him without eating and drinking for days on end. And we are his disciples. The Lord said, learn of me. Where is it? Matthew's Gospel, chapter 11, verse 29. Learn of me. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. When we don't do that, when we don't pay the price, where is the learning, friends? You don't read the Word of God. You don't know how to pray. You don't know how to fast. You don't know how to go alone to the presence of God. And you don't know how to say no to a lot of wasteful experience in your life. How do you think you will ever learn good words? I have offended my wife so many times through my words in the past years. And then God brought that sensation into my life. What is it you are doing? And because when God has brought a person into my life, if I hurt the lady, who will get hurt? God will get hurt. It's dangerous if God gets hurt. God can judge. God can condemn. And sometimes the punishment will be long-lasting, friends. Then harsh words, clinging to your own viewpoint, unteachable attitude, digging up the past failures all the time. You pack them up in something. Okay, in 2006 you did like this. In April you did like this. In May you did like this. Don't think I have forgotten. I know all these things. How foolish if we can bring up all that stuff. It's like carrying dirty socks instead of washing them, putting them in your pocket and spoiling the whole atmosphere. Friends, let your life be under the washing of the Word of God from now on. We need to repent. We need to get out of all these things. Lack of humility can make us drift apart through a difference. Now, what is the solution for such things? Through differences. Now, don't panic if your spouse is different from you at all, but understand the difference. Differences show the needs. Differences show needs. Our inadequacies. The areas where we need to improve. My wife is slow. I am fast. And my wife's need is to get a little faster. And my need is to get a little slower. Going too slow is not good. Going too fast also is not good. You need to know what kind of a speed you need to maintain so that both the people can move together. Somebody spends money like this, like water. Somebody doesn't spend at all. Both are wrong again. You need to leave a little more and you need to catch hold a little more. Your life would be in balance. Differences show needs, the areas that I need to improve upon. And take time to prayerfully resolve the differences. When I have a difference with my wife or husband, the best thing that I should do is sit together. Talk about it. You need to go from one level to another level to another level. We said so many levels. I think about 7 levels we have seen. Greeting level, and then welfare level, and then need level, and then mood level, and then feeling level, to the reality level, right? Sympathy level. Sympathy level is the 6th level, and the reality level is 2nd level. If you find an area where you don't agree with one another, my dear brothers, my dear sisters, please take this counsel. Sit together. You know what the Lord said? Come, let us reason together. Isaiah chapter 1. The Lord never said, I am right. He is always right, of course. But then he did not say that there. He said, come, let us reason together. What a God we have. How nicely he teaches us lessons to foolish people like us. Children are growing. They are coming for marriage. They will fly away. And you two will remain. And when you two only will remain, what will happen in the house with all these differences unless you resolve the situation now by the power of the Holy Spirit? It's a serious matter. When everybody goes off, flies off, that is the time where you should relax, enjoy one another, enjoy each other's company, and you need preparation for that. And most of the couples have never made any preparations for that. And therefore, this fellow goes on into the street all the time, and she keeps on keeping herself in somebody's house all the time. Why this pathetic lifestyle? You say that my daughter is in America, my son is in England. What is it for? When you don't have anything to talk to one another, when you can't enjoy life together, pray together, read the word together, laugh together and joke together, why do you live together in the first place? God has meant for good, but we have turned it to a bad situation. So differences can be complementary. They'll repair us. My wife's strength will be useful for my weakness. And my strength will be useful for my wife's weakness. That's how we need to see. And that's how things will happen. The third thing is personal sin. The attack comes through personal sin. Remember that we all have a fallen nature and beware of various sinful practices and habits and also customs and traditions. Beware of disobeying God's will and ways. If you sin, the devil will operate through you in your family and others get affected. Remember, we have the fallen nature still with us. We have a new nature as believers. If you are not a believer, you have only one nature, that is the fallen nature. If you are a born again Christian, then you have two natures, the sin nature and the new nature. The new nature is capable of putting the sin nature out of its course and win over it and give you victory day after day, provided you follow the Lord Jesus Christ according to His word, according to the dictates of the Holy Spirit, and show obedience in every aspect. Now, because of this fallen nature, that sin can come into our lives. Any sin, it can be a habit, it can be a secret sin, it can be a dirty relationship, it can be some kind of a mental thing, it can be some practice somewhere in your office or in your neighborhood or somewhere, it can be a monetary matter, or it can be relationship problem, or it can be jealousy, it can be lack of love, whatever. Personal sin, if it is not resolved, it's going to trouble you a lot, friends. And beware of various sinful practices and habits. You should be careful. Maybe you are giving bribes and taking bribes. Maybe you tell lies just like that. White lies, exaggerations, covering the truth, all kinds of lies. You open the windows and the doors for the devil. Remember, sin will never exist as a single sin. It always exists in groups. David sinned. The problem is adultery. What else came into his life? Lies, hypocrisy, hatred, deceit, murder, pretension. All kinds of things have come. And what has happened to all these things? They carried into his generation. God waited for one full year for David to repent. He did not repent. He kept on sinning. Foolish 1 year's time. If you sleep over your sin, the sin will be at your door. It will rule over you. You should be very, very careful about these things. Therefore, bring whatever sin that you could discover, find, identify in your own life to the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, where every sin is crucified intentionally, volitionally, voluntarily, purposely, actively. That's what Colossians chapter 3 says. Mortify your deeds in the flesh. Kill them. Don't spare them. Personal sin is very dangerous. Sometimes it will carry on into generations. David committed adultery. Solomon committed more adultery. Another son committed another adultery. There was a rape in the family. There was adultery in the family. There's a wretchedness in the family. He opened the door once. His children opened the door many times. Friends, when sin passes on to the next generation, it is more wild. Don't let your children have more sin in their lives because you are careful today. Let us all take notice of this horror of the consequences of sin. Beware of sinful influences through media, people, and associations. Don't tell me that this man is a godly man, this man is a elder, pastor, or something, or something, or something. The devil can use any one of us. It can be a parent, it can be an in-law, it can be a so-called godly man, it can be a healer, it can be a prophetess, whatever. Anyone can be used by the devil as an agency. When you identify something wrong, counsel is coming through them, shut the door. Protect your family, protect your spouses, protect your children. That's what we need to do. If it is media, shut the media off. If it's people, shut the people off. If it is an association or friendship with somebody, shut the association off. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, perilous times are coming in the end. Paul warns Timothy. There are 19 varieties of people from which Paul tells Timothy, depart from such people. Why? After all, we are here to tell God, tell other people about God. But Paul says, depart from them. Don't have anything to do with such categories of people. Friends, what for? For my own family, for my own life. God is calling for purity in marriages, holiness in marriages, wholesomeness in our marriages. Can we present God that? Lord, you brought us together. And then we bring our marriage to you on this anniversary day. Lord, by your grace, we kept it pure and righteous and holy. Will you continue to bless us, Master? Bless us on this day so that one more year we can live for you with your strength, with your grace. That should be our prayer, friends. Personal sin can trouble us and also our children. So let's be very, very careful. There can be very strange and mean behavior of violence, harshness, and anger on the part of the spouse or children, nagging, criticism, insensitivity, etc. You know what is opposite of love? Whatever happens to that person, you're not sensitive anymore for the person's life, towards the person's life. Insensitivity, you become kind of callous to whatever happens to the other person. That is the opposite of love. Many times we think that hatred, since I don't hate my wife, I'm okay. But since you don't love your wife, you are not okay. And you are so insensitive, you don't bother about her needs. You don't bother about his problems and his headaches. And therefore, you are already committing sin in your life. How many years will it take to understand us, how to identify sin? Friends, the time has come to go deeper into the Word of God, to go again and again into the presence of God and identify sin by its name and call it by its own name with our own lips and say with tears, Lord, I am the man. Forgive me. Cleanse me. Make me again. Build me up again. The devil is prowling. He is waiting at the door. Since you stopped him, he is waiting. Otherwise, he would have come already. Lord, have mercy. Give me another chance. Our God is a merciful God. Our God is a kind God. He brought us together and therefore he is guarding us jealously. Do you understand that? Who guards your marriage, friends? God has guarded. Your Lord has guarded. Even though we are not worthy of it. Let's change our attitudes of marriage, thinking that everything will be okay if I keep on going to the church, keep a big Bible under my shoulder and all kinds of funny things. No, it doesn't happen like that. It needs more than ordinary spirituality and a righteousness that is more than that of the Pharisees and Sadducees to make you qualified before a holy God. Don't take God's words very lightly. This is a time where God challenges you and I for a better quality spiritual life. The spouses have to protect one another. Friends, in your marriage, do you have a destination? Do you have a goal? Do you have a fruitful life before your eyes as a dream? You will be a vagabond. You will be moving all the time, making no progress. Movement itself is not progress. Progress is something different. Movement is something totally different. God said he punished him by making him a vagabond because this man would not listen to God. Be careful, friends. So spouses have to protect themselves, one another, and they have to get the strength through prayer, word of God, and fellowshipping together. When God is countering us, encountering us, will you meet your God and sit with him as a family and set things right from now on? Protect one another. And you get the strength in the word of God and prayer and fellowship. Praying together is very, very important. And the other thing is, other attack is immorality, adultery, in other words. Now, all of us can become vulnerable to this sin, can be caused by sexual starvation during conflicts, and can be caused by long spells of abstinence, unhealthy emotional relationships at the workplace, sometimes even through fantasies. Be careful, friends. There is always the danger of committing adultery with the opposite sex. There are always better men. There are always better women than our spouses. And you move in today's world with such people all the time in your office, in your neighborhood, among your relation circle. What kind of eyes you have, what kind of thoughts you have. Are the thoughts captive to the Lord Jesus Christ? Are they under control? And what is your attitude to the opposites? How distant you keep yourself from them? It's not a question of physical distance. I'm talking about the mental distance. What kind of a discipline you bring into your body, your mind, and all your sexual habits? Have a healthy sex with your wife. As much as you want. God said, enjoy both of you together. Be fruitful and multiply and enjoy life, God said. That's why God has given sex. Not only for having children, but even for a great enjoyment in life. And that can only be enjoyed within the boundaries of a healthy married life. If it spills over, goes outside, that becomes dirty to any degree. And God is not going to leave anyone there. Marriage is honorable in all. And God will judge if the bed is defiled. And every adulterer will be judged. Hebrews 13:4 says. Now we must understand that unhealthy emotional relationships, sometimes you have a tendency to be very sympathetic towards certain women or men at your workplace. So generally, women have got a tendency to shed tears when somebody shows them a lot of sympathy. Friends, let's be very careful. That's why without your wife, never counsel a woman. In the first place, don't counsel women. Why should you counsel? Direct them to some other lady of a good repute, good spiritual caliber. Don't ever be sitting on a scooter with another woman. Never be found in a car when the third person is not there. Never be locked up in a room or a hotel or some place where the third person is absent. These are the basic things that are taught even by the business world, not the religious world. Then how are we doing, Christians, breaking all these things? Let's understand, friends. Maintain a safe distance. Keep the minds clean. Keep away all fantasies out from you. Keep the fantasies out. What is a fantasy? I imagine some other lady who appeals to my mind and heart and body in the place of my wife in all my thoughts. That is fantasy. We need to be very careful in this. A polluted mind, a polluted eye results in a polluted mind. And a polluted mind results in a polluted body. And a polluted body results in a polluted relationship. And the sin gets in. Many people will get defined. That's what Paul says. The author of Hebrews says in the second chapter of Hebrews, second or third chapter, says that if there is a bitter root, in the 12th chapter of Hebrews, he says, if any bitter root would spring up and thereby many would be defiled. Sin would not defile one man. It always defiles many people. Now God is asking me and you. God is a merciful God, but God also is a consuming fire. Let every Christian understand this. Let every preacher understand this. Let everybody understand this, whoever speaks of God. God is a great merciful God and Father, but He's also a consuming fire. Adultery is very dangerous. Immorality starts with a look. The Lord said in Matthew's Gospel, if somebody looks upon a woman with a dirty look, therefore what we need to do? Discipline the eyes. Takes time. It's not easy, friends. It comes from the Lord and it comes from His presence. Improper behavior with the opposite sex, even in the context of ministry. Be careful. Don't go too near. Don't go too close. You should not go so near that you can smell the clothes. Be careful, friends. Be careful. Dress modestly. Your looks must be disciplined. Your demeanor, your mannerisms must be disciplined. And that's how you save yourself and others from the attacks of the evil one. Undisciplined eyes and minds. Unmet sexual needs. If I have enough food at home, I would not go to a hotel. Right? God has given you good food at home. Eat it. You don't run after somebody else. And therefore, unmet sexual needs must be met in the family context. Improper behavior. Don't joke too much. Don't visit too much. When a woman is alone, there is no business for you to visit her, even though you are a pastor. or an elder, or an evangelist, or a deacon, whatever you are. Only when the husband is there, you should go there. Or if your wife is along with you, then only you should go there. And the vice versa. Then the devil seasons us with sexual material before he pushes us over into the sin. Now, the devil is not in a hurry to make us commit sin. He soaks us in sin for a long period of time. Like we soak clothes in water, he soaks us in sinful atmosphere and environment for a long time. He's not in a hurry. He waits for his chance. He waits for his chance. He did it for Joseph. There are steps in which the devil will take you through. He will mellow you. He will smoothen you. He will soften you in your stand over a long period of time. Then comes a day when all your strength has left you. You think that God is with you. But on that day, you do not know that the Lord has already departed. You are already sleeping in the lap of a prostitute. Samson, a man sent by God, who has got a mysterious strength in his body and mind, became a foolish slave of the Philistines because his mind was not in his control. His body was not in his control. So let's be very careful about that. And then the troubled children is another attack that comes on the family. Devil's attack on children is common. There will be emotional disturbances, poor performance studies, wild music, demonic symbols like tattoos and objects, mysterious sicknesses, voices in the head. If your children are listening, hearing any voices in their head, do this, do that, there is a demonic attack. Be very careful about that. Ungodly and wayward behavior. Or if the children are complaining as if somebody is moving in the nights in their room, take them seriously. Don't say, oh, it's all psychological and all that. No, don't say that. It's not psychological. Children are not fools. They are more honest than men. Therefore, attend to that very quickly. Ungodly and wayward behavior. Some of the children are already showing the signs of that. Be careful, friends. Ungodly, wayward behavior. Come on, watch it. Desire for loneliness for long hours of time. They don't want to mix anyone. They want to sit in dark rooms. They don't play. They don't mix with other people. These are some of the tendencies. Slavery to bad habits like drugs, movies, internet pornography, cheap and pornographic literature, chatting on the net endlessly in violent reactions and wild rebellion, swearing and abusive language, and immodest dressing, outlandish hairstyles and other fashions, fetishes, interest in the occult, and all these things. What are the solutions? The solutions are don't lose courage, first thing. Then be wise to monitor the children and recognize the strange trends, if any. Be together as a couple in such a time. Don't brush it aside as part of the growing process. Don't try to blame a child as he goes through all these things, all these phases. But then as a couple, you need to do a few things. Rescuing your child is your own responsibility. Rescue your child. Fight the devil and put him to flight. Be a prayer warrior. And then protect your children by building walls around them. Trust the Lord for help. And then bring them up in godly nurture. I want to show you, along with me, the book of Job. 10 children. For each one of them, he would offer sacrifices in the presence of God. How much time does it take? If you give a sacrifice for every child, how much time? How much minimum time would it take? At least 2 hours. He would confess the children's cases. He would bring each child into the presence of God. Every morning, he gets up early in the morning. Where are the parents who will get up early in the morning and then run to their knees and cry for their children? We need Jobs to be blessed. We need Jobs. What did Job do? He called them up. He inquired what kind of a mischief they have done. They cleansed them. And in the morning, he used to go to God. And then for each one of them, he would give a kind of a bali, a sacrifice. While he was doing it, what was God doing? Building hedges around the family. Look at this, friends. When you do what you are supposed to do, when God does what you cannot do, you cannot build a hedge around. Satan cannot come. Who will build the hedge? The Lord, Satan says, Hast thou not made a hedge? You made a hedge. Why? He offered the offerings for every child. This is the principle of godly children and godly parents. How are your children kept? Who will kept a hedge around your children? You have kept a hedge. Why? There is somebody who paid the price, the father. Friends, will you learn a lesson today? Your children need your priesthood. You should become a kind of a savior to your children. You must be the person between your children and God. Are you crying for your children? Are you shedding tears for your children? Is there a burden in your life for your children? Whatever they talk goes, whatever thing happens goes, wherever they go, it's okay. Chalta hai, sab chalta hai hamare liye. In such families, God will not build hedges. If you are disciplined like Job, if you are godly and hate evil like Job, then take time in the morning, sacrifice your sleep, get up early in the morning, forget about riches and reach out to God for help. Then God will build the hedges for your family. Not only that, God not only built hedges, but he brought blessings into his family. The devil is saying, what can I do? You have built hedges around the family. You have blessed everything. I cannot do anything. I cannot touch them. The Lord must have smiled. Of course, yes. I bless all such people. Why is it recorded here? So that my family and your family may be like this family. So bring them in godly nurture. Trust the Lord for help. Protect your children. What is it that we need to do is go to God. Cry for them. Get ready for the battle. Get your children from the mouth of the devil. It has happened in our life, in our family, to our own children. We got him back. There was a demonic operation in our family. We identified it. We went to God. We fought for our son. Got him back. Our son could tell us, Dad, I think I was under demonic operation. These are real experiences. And then we need to be ready for all that kind of warfare. See whether there is unconfessed sin in them or in you both. Consider generational sins and break their power by God's help. There are certain generational sins which occur in your families, done by your fathers, done by your grandfathers and other ancestors. You need to break those bondages and their curses and their consequences by confessing their sins. Daniel did it. Nehemiah did it. Prophets did it. Many people did it. And therefore, we need to confess their sin and say, Lord, they did not know how to confess, but I confess that sin. Lord, stop this danger coming upon my children, my daughters, my sons, and upon us. You can break generational curses and generational dangers by going to God and pleading with him, not for one day, friends. It takes time. It's a costly affair. You need patience. You need perseverance. You need a fighting spirit. You need a killer instinct. Kill the devil. Kill the devil. Fight with him. Finish him. You need to be spiritually very, very sound to do that. Educate your children sufficiently in advance. And then remember Abraham and Job for your example. In-laws and parents. And these are the people sometimes that cause problems. Some of them act like agents of the devil. But then be wise to recognize this and be together always as a couple. And show your oneness. And be very careful in dealing with them. Some want to dominate and interfere. Materialism. Beware of unhealthy craving to have all things at home. Watch for the traps of earning more and getting more and more busy thereby. Remember the warnings about love for money. Set your priorities right. Be separate for a few sacrifices. Be prepared for a few sacrifices to live in peace and in contentment. If you don't have a refrigerator, a sophisticated refrigerator, it's okay. If you don't have an oven, if you don't have a system, it's all right. We can still live without it. As long as I was working in the bank, I did not have many things in my home. I'm not trying to make a big issue out of it, trying to gain merit out of it. No. I did not have money and therefore I did not purchase. Simple as that. So what? Theek hai. Now if it's not there, it's not there. If it is there, it is there. That's it. If I don't have money, I don't purchase. Simple. It should be our attitude. So materialism should not catch up with us. The whole world is doing it, but you are not going to do it. And then facing difficult situations. We all go through the rough weather sooner or later, and so be prepared. They can come in the form of financial problems, transfers, problems with relatives, neighbors, colleagues, children's education or health, health challenges, etc. And then sometimes these are of our own making. Don't search for scapegoats. Don't throw the blame on somebody when something goes wrong because of our own foolishness. Sometimes transfers come in a very bad situation. And sometimes promotion does not come. People will be complaining against us. There may be a case against us. And then colleagues are not to be trusted. Neighbors cannot be trusted. Relatives cannot be trusted. Children's education is a problem. Health challenges. These are real problems for real people. Don't get discouraged. Be courageous in times like this. When you are in a warfare, you should not be fearful. That's why the Lord said, whenever the Israelites have selected an army, he would say, all the timid fellows go home, because you will be a nuisance for others in the fellowship. So you better not come to the fellowship at all. You discredit other people. Therefore, that's why the Lord said, flee from youthful lusts and follow love, faith, and other things with those who would lift up holy hands and pray. Courageous people, bold people, join with them and continue with them. And therefore, be careful. When these situations come, don't lose heart. Trust the Lord. Check whether you have broken any God's commands. First thing, if anything goes wrong, check whether anything has been broken. We need to be searching for answers within our family first. Lord, did I do anything wrong? See, the disciples, when the Lord Jesus said, one of you is going to betray me, the Lord said. You know what the question of the disciples was? What was the question? Am I the one? If we were to be there, we would say, who is it, Lord? The disciples said, Lord, is it me? See, look at their degree of humility. Other people are very good in their sight. If at all there is a culprit, it should be me. See the level of humility that they were brought to because they were with the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you understand this? This cannot be understood by silly people, by ordinary people, by an average Christian. It's kind of foolishness to him. Friends, let us check. Check whether you have obeyed all known will of God. Check whether you are following any worldly ways or traditions or customs. Check your relationships. Learn to go to the Lord for comfort, wisdom, and for solutions. There is a solution for every problem. Where? In the Word. Too much work causes stress. Why are we saying stress also can be a point of attack? Just listen to me. A tired mind is a target for the devil. Even in the ministry, a tired mind is a target for the devil. That is why we are advised to take sufficient rest. That is why God has given them what? Sabbath. After every 6 days, God provided them rest. You know why? Recuperation. Reclamation of power. Renovation of their infrastructure. And then revival in the presence of God. That is why when God gave them a holiday, it was not a holiday that we think, it was a holy day for God's people. If you get a holiday, some people have got the habit of running into ministry all the time. Brother, it is contrary to the word of God. If you do it too much, cross the borders, cross the limits. We be within the limits. I can understand if you want to use a day for ministry, but when you badly need rest and God has sent that rest is a Sabbath rest for you. Take it. Enjoy it. Sleep. Relax. Have some good food. Talk to your wife. Spend time with children. You are ready for the next day. Because a stressed out mind is a soft target for the devil. Learn to enjoy God's rest, His quietness and His peace. Learn to relax and take rest. Have physical activity or exercise or change the activity. Don't give room for undue worries. Now, depression is a thing that attacks all women at one time or the other. Of course, men also comes, but for men it is crisis oriented. But for women, for every small thing, depression sets in. One of the deadliest of the attacks, somebody told me many years back, Satan held an exhibition of all the instruments that he uses. So people were seeing all the instruments. Their names were written there. And there was one instrument which had no handle. So somebody asked the devil, why you have prepared everything for an exhibition, why is it that there is no handle for this? The devil said, there is no time to fix a handle for this. Then they asked him, why? Because it is the most frequently used weapon. What is the name? Depression. Friends, this is real. I might have told you a kind of a story, but then it's more than a story. It's very real. Be careful, be careful. Depression can set in for some. See, for the devil to make you a soft target for all kinds of negative thoughts and for weakening, for taking away Bible from you, for taking away fellowship from you, from the Word of God from you, he has to depress you. Depression can set in. Therefore, immediately run to good music, into fellowship, to some family. Call for fellowship. Don't be alone. And don't be lonely. It can be caused by failure, rejection, disappointment, self-pity, low self-worth, loneliness, loss of material goods, or bereavement, retirement, loss of health, guilt feelings, indisciplined children, etc. Women suffer for it for no reason, because women have got their bodily functions because of the hormonal disturbances, and therefore they show signs of depression. People under depression drift away from the Word of God and prayer and fellowship. Generally, it happens. They have guilt feelings, thoughts of death, redundancy, emptiness, dullness, imaginary fears, lack of sleep, tiredness, insecure feelings, etc., resulting out of depression. And then, what is the antidote for depression? Give reassurances for such people. Accept such people. Comfort them. If you are a husband, do this. If you are a wife, do this. Accept your spouse. Comfort. Encourage. Give fellowship. Recognize the person's merit. That can be of great help. And be constantly reminded of God's unfailing love and faithfulness. That is why these people need to be reminded of God's love and faithfulness. That is why family altar every day can relieve you from distress. Because you sing, you praise, you worship, you touch God's throne of grace, and you are rescued. Keep building hedges around your families. Don't trust your talents, education, or even family background for protection. Learn to cast your care upon the Lord. 1 Peter 5:7, because he cares for you. Worshipping the Lord, especially along with others, is a great remedy. Trust God for all needs and for all circumstances. David went through depression. He says, my soul, why are you cast down within me? Trust in God and he will rescue you from all. What is that? Self-talk. He was talking to himself. My soul, why are you cast down? There are reasons for my soul to be cast down. What is the antidote? Trust in God. Believe in him. Remember his words. David says in Psalm 119, as a pilgrim, as I was traveling, in my distress, your word was the reason for me to sing in the nights. Songs will come out of depression. You know, in the place of depression, song can come. That's the work of the Word of God, friends. Let us understand this and appreciate the Word of God and be a good student and meditator of God's Word. That's why he wrote Psalm 1. Blessed is the man who delights in the law of the Lord day and night. All that he does will be successful, etc. Trust God for all needs and for all circumstances. If one spouse is down, the other must come to the rescue. Now, spiritual cleansing. Sometimes in your house, there are inherited behaviors, invited possessions. Dowry could have been there, or your father might have earned an amount of money through unjust means and passed it on as gold or furniture into your house. Whom does the furniture belong? To God or to the devil? Tell me, please. The devil. Common sense, tell us. Now, the devil will come and sit in his sofa all the time. It is his furniture. And then when there is a necklace around your neck, which has come through unjust means, he will hang on to the necklace. And you will have the devil in your neck. You think the life will be comfortable then? Be careful. Everything that comes into your family must be tested, how it comes. But the Bhagat Singh story tells us that he is a very rich man. Father wanted to give all the property. God said, don't touch it. He preferred to be poor and be blessed by God rather than to receive millions of rupees and be troubling himself. Friends, let us test. How do you get the gifts? There could be some mementos in your houses, some images of certain graven images on cloths, on tokens, on some objects. These things sometimes are the replicas of demonic symbols. Be careful, friends. There are many, many such symbols. God speaks about them. We need to be clean. That's why we called it spiritual cleansing. Cleanse your furniture. Cleanse your money. Cleanse your possessions. That is why our homes must be cleansed spiritually. Why do you think we all go for a housewarming and pray for every room there? Spiritual cleansing. Therefore, you need to pray. Go back to your places. Whatever is of a doubtful character, throw it out. Throw it out. Remove it. You may suffer some loss, but it's okay. But you will gain more when you do that. Beware of inherited behaviors. Suppose if a part of your behavior, you are behaving like your grandfather, if you are behaving like your uncle, maternal uncle or paternal uncle, this is an inherited behavior. Cut it off in prayer. Cut it off in the presence of God. Get deliverance from it. God will make your home clean. Spiritual problems need spiritual solutions. Remember that the devil is the enemy of our families and children. And our values and our standards and all principles for living have to be drawn from the word of God alone. 1 John 4:4. What does it say? Greater is he who is in you than he that is in the world. That's the devil. Greater is he who is in me. Cling on to him. Hang on to him. Hang on in his presence. God has called you to the fellowship of his son and himself. Enjoy it. 1 John 1:3. And God has called you to the fellowship. Don't go away from there. That is where you will be recharged, renewed, regrouped, restored, revived, and then released into the world as a winner. Get cleansed, friends. Get cleansed spiritually. Cleansing is very, very important. It all boils down again to the word of God. The solution always comes through the word of God. I would only invite you to become the students of the word of God. Immerse yourself. Soak yourself in the word of God. Delight in the law of the Lord. And whatever you do in the family will be very fruitful. And blessed is the man, so goes the psalm. Will you inherit that blessing? It's all in your hands. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for this time that you have granted to us to be with you and your word and your spirit, learning about the spiritual aspects and the real aspects of a family life from various angles. You have taught us many things. You have reminded us of many things. And we have understood that the word of God is the source of our strength. And it is the light, and it is light. And it only provides the solutions for all our problems. Therefore, Lord, we come back to you, running into your hands this evening with our spouses and with our children in our minds. Heavenly Father, have mercy upon each one of us. We all need you, Lord. We all need a revival. We repent of our sin, Lord. We hate sin from now on. Give us that hatred like Job had. And renew our lives. Draw us closer to thy throne of grace every day. Help us to begin the day with your love and end the day in your faithfulness. And let us give you a clean chit at the end of the day, Lord. We want to be clean before you, Master. We don't want to commit sin and get curse and dangerous consequences on ourselves and on our children, the coming generations. And Lord, if there is spiritual cleansing necessary for my family and our spouses and our children, I beg you, Lord, I plead with you, Lord, that you will render that cleansing to me and to all my brothers and sisters here. We ask you, Father, not to pass us by. Abide with us, Lord, with us, with our spouses and with our children. Build our homes, build our houses, build our families, build our relationships. May we love the Lord with all our heart and with all our strength, with all our might and with all our mind, and love our spouses and our children with all our heart too. Father, we pray that there will be a great revival in our family lives, dear Lord. Forgive us all for all the foolish things that we have committed, knowingly or unknowingly. Help us, Father, to be sober, with your eyes open, with our ears open, guarding our families and building hedges by going to God in prayer every day, and protecting our children in prayer, and by sacrifices, spiritual sacrifices before God. Lord, you have done so much for us. Help us to sustain those things in our lives and enjoy the life that you have given to us, and enjoy the spouses that you have given to us as never before. Father, together we all want to lay our family lives into your hands. Some of them are broken, some of them are in pieces. Father, please mend them right. Reconstruct them for us, for your glory, for your honor. Our houses must be dwelling places of God in the days ahead, where God would delight in. Our families would be places of delight for God. Heavenly Father, in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, forgive us all our sins and cleanse us, Father, at this moment. Our sin is always before us. And as we come to you in repentance and in humility, Lord, we pray that you will have compassion on us, mend our lives, and make us humble people before you, hanging around you all the time, hanging on to the cross for killing our sin, and hanging on to the throne of grace for every strength that we need in our lives. Heavenly Father, help us to hang around the Word of God so that the Word of God can protect us and give us life in every situation. Visit each family, encounter every family, and spend time with them, Lord, speaking to their need. Heavenly Father, have mercy on them. Bless their families, mend their families, and make them a blessing. Remember their children. Remember the attacks that they are going to face from now onwards. Prepare them for the battle. Make them winners all the way. The purpose for which they have been brought together, Lord, my prayer is that you should fulfill that purpose from now on. Accept us, dear Lord, and accept our prayer, and use us for your glory and honor, and build your church through us. We ask it in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.